Please support. My name's Dan Walt. I represent the appellant, in this case, John R. Stowe. Yes, I would like to reserve 5 minutes for what is appropriate. In trying to prepare for this appeal, it's very difficult to try and crunch the appeal and all of the facts and circumstances and everything that's gone on in this case down into a time that is concise and can address all of the facts, but I'll do the best that I can. These parties, the defendant in this case, Chuck Zabo, owns some property out off of Maslin Road. It's roughly three buildings. The building in the middle is called Building 2. It's blocked into certain areas that are leased. We're talking about Section B of that. Back in 2013, the parties entered into a lease agreement whereby Chuck's agreed to lease the property to John R. Stowe, managing member of SB Contracting, for the sum of $500 a month plus $75 utilities. All of the utilities are, none of them are individually metered. Everything is provided to the entity through the entire building. Mr. Stowe took possession of the property. At that time, Mr. Stowe's in the business of doing flooring, so he's carpeting, hardwood flooring, and tile. One particular interest in the lease is there's a provision in the lease that specifically says that the landlord will maintain and make all necessary repairs to the roof structure, etc. There's a contractual provision that's obligated the lessor to the lessee. In this case, I'll move forward to roughly the period of time after that. During the period of time that he maintained possession of the leasehold premises, there were roof leaks. There was a roof leak underneath the mezzanine, and the ceiling actually collapsed due to a leak. There were two other leaks over the warehouse structure. My client asked them to repair these. The repairs were not made. What my client did was basically take all of his inventory and move it around so that it wasn't in an area where the leaks would fall on his product. On November 24, which is the day at issue here, my client, as is customary, drives his vehicle to the leasehold premises, parks his vehicle outside, goes in, loads up his van, he and his son load up the van, and off they go to install flooring at somebody's house, or whether it's commercial, residential, whatever. At that point in time, the vehicle he drove was an S10 pickup truck, which was licensed to John R. Stowe. That pickup truck had about four months earlier had a custom paint job on it. It was pristine, absolutely pristine when it was parked at the site that morning. They drove off. When they came back at day's end, it was night, it was roughly 7 o'clock in the evening. When they came back, pulled the van in and exited the building through a passage door, the light from inside shined out on the pickup truck. At that point in time, his son, John, noticed that there were scratches across the front of the hood of the pickup truck on the driver's side. At that point in time, he took out a look at him and said, oh my gosh, what's going on here? He noticed a tar mark up on the hood, these scratches that went all the way through the paint into the metal, and laying in front of the car was a shingle, a dark shingle which had evidence that it had been nailed to the roof. It's laying there. He began to look around the rest of the car, and he also noticed that the driver's door, up above the driver's door and the roof, and the frame of the door and the windshield, was another tar mark. There were scratches down the side of the on the windshield, down the side of the door frame, onto the rearview mirror, and the side of the thing. Laying on the ground in a puddle of mud was a second shingle. That one was a little bit lighter, and it showed evidence having been stapled to the roof. Now the roof at issue is a big long building. Half of the roof on the east side is extremely old shingles, been repaired numerous times, brittle, etc. They were the dark shingles that had been nailed. On the other side of the roof is a lighter colored shingle that had been replaced. Directly in front of the car, the vehicle, and immediately above it, when they step back, they look up and they see shingles sticking up in the breeze, flopping in the wind. At that time, he took an immediate photograph with an iPhone of the damage to the vehicle. He took a photograph of the shingles laying on the ground immediately in front of and adjacent to the vehicle. They took photos of the shingles sticking up in the air. They made an attempt to call the owner, Chuck's Automotive. The call was not accepted, nor was it returned. At that point in time, my client, John Stowe, picked up the shingles and put them in a plastic bag. He set the bag inside of the leasehold property. The next morning they came back, they left the truck exactly where it was. The next morning they came back, they took another set of photographs in the morning, the roof, shingles sticking up, and the damage to the car. Again, he tried to contact Chuck's Automotive. No return call, didn't answer the phone.
Could you see shingles missing from the roof or just sticking up?
Well, if you look at it, the way they're, it's possible that their shingles were missing, but my client didn't go up and look. He didn't have access to the roof. All we know is the shingles are laying there, and they obviously came from the roof. They had been nailed and stapled to the something, and that obviously would be the roof. The next day, my client drove down to try and explain to him what had happened. He was not available. They left the car sit exactly where it was. The vehicle went off to work that day as they had the day before. When they came back at day's end, there were pieces and parts of shingles sitting on the windshield of the vehicle, and the roof had been patched or repaired. At some point, there was some animosity between these parties. As I said, after that, the landlord basically sent them a notice and said, it's time for you to leave. We filed a lawsuit. We filed a lawsuit in the Barber Municipal Court, and we attached a copy of the contract indicating that the terms of the contract specifically required him to maintain and perform all necessary repairs. We stated that he failed to do so and that the damage to the truck was caused by the shingles. Now, this is a circumstantial case. No one saw what happened. There are no witnesses that saw what happened. All we know is the shingles are laying there, they're flopping in the breeze up above, and that's what we know. Now, we claim the circumstantial case, the evidence is that's where the shingles came from. They came from the roof onto the vehicle. Now, there was testimony given. We provided all of those photographs. We provided the shingles themselves. We provided everything to the court. Defense argument at that time was the damage to the vehicle was pre-existing. They offered a photograph of the car 2 months beforehand showing the passenger's fender where the sun had glared off the fender and said, see, the damage was pre-existing. Well, the damage to the vehicle complained of was on the other side of the car. It was in the front on the driver's side and on the driver's side door. So, you know, that being what it is, they offered the testimony. We put the defendant on the case in our case in chief on cross-exam. He admitted that he replaced four or five shingles, and that he had done so that afternoon on the 25th, the day after the incident occurred. A week later, when the case was continued for a week later, when he came case in chief, he said, no, I didn't. I didn't replace any shingles. So it's a self-serving testimony of the defendant that just flat out doesn't make sense in this case. He also then tried to testify that the shingles came from underneath a downspout. He showed a photograph of shingles under a downspout that were just laying there, which made no sense to me either. The other thing that he had is, oh, I recognize these shingles. They came from my demo pile, my debris pile. Hundreds of feet away, with no explanation of how it is they would have come to fall on the car and cause the damage. So the testimony is rather strange. And they also offered the testimony of Mr. Dice. Mr. Dice was retained 2 days before he testified, roughly 5 days after the case was initially heard. Mr. Dice testified he's never seen the property prior to that day. He has no idea when any of the repairs were done, what repairs were done, when they were done. He did testify, however, that the shingles on the east side of the roof were bad. They should have been replaced long ago. that they were broken, they were brittle. It was evidence that they had been, that that side of the roof had been patched and repaired on numerous occasions. And he also testified that the other side, who was newer, had evidence that that had been patched and repaired on at least 4 or 5 occasions. He further testified that the area in question where the shingles were raised showed evidence that shingles had been repaired. Critically, he said, in my opinion, those repairs have not happened since 2014. The date claimed up here is November 24th, 2014. Now, what's the importance that the court made? We objected to the magistrate's report. We said there's no evidence. I'm sorry, we failed our burden of proof to show that the shingles came off the roof and damaged the car. On objection, the court came back and said, well, you haven't proven that he was negligent in repairing the roof. Well, that's not the standard in this case. This is a contract case with a specific provision that says, thou shalt maintain and make all necessary repairs. Negligence is not necessarily an issue here unless you look at a common law requirement.
Mm-hmm. You're down to your rebuttal time.
Okay.
You may proceed.
With it. No, I will save some rebuttal time. Okay. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Terrence Huffholz for Chuck's Auto. May it please the court, Mr. Walpole. In litigation such as we had in Barberton, it is not unusual to have a dispute as to the facts. And we certainly had a dispute there. However, I will tell you that the level of the dispute of the facts in this case goes beyond the purview of an honest dispute. The important thing for the trial court is to listen to the evidence and to determine the credibility of the witnesses. And I suggest to you that there's a great issue of credibility in this case, and that the trial court, in determining that credibility and looking at the supporting evidence, determined in favor of Chuck's Auto and not SB Contracting. And certainly the trial court is the best determiner of those things. And I will tell you that I could spend a great deal of time arguing about the facts in this case, because the facts as presented by Mr. Stowe were skewed. They were based upon his impressions and observations of things, which aren't true. I will get into a few of them, but first of all, we have to take a look and see who the parties are here. Mr. Stowe was not a party to the lease. He seems to conveniently forget that. This lease was between SB Contracting Services and Chuck's Auto, not Mr. Stowe. So he is claiming obligations flowing to him from a lease that was not in his name. The trial court did identify that type of an issue because Chuck's filed a counterclaim against SB regarding the vehicle that was repaired, and the trial court said, hey, SB's not a party to this case, and they denied that claim on behalf of Chuck's Auto. So we have to be careful here who the parties are and where the obligations flow. Also, if we take a look at the law, in the brief that is cited by the appellant, they are attempting to impose residential requirements that are under the residential laws, and the cases that they cited are residential cases, and this is not that. This is a commercial case. So I would submit to you that the law is against them. I would submit to you that the facts are against them. when we look at what happened here, SB Contracting engaged space for storage, cold storage. What they attempted to do then thereafter was to make auto repairs. They were painting cars in there. They were doing many things beyond the purview of the lease. And when Chuck's Auto came over and said, hey, you are renting cold storage space, you need to stop these other activities, then the situation between these parties deteriorated down to what I can only describe as a vendetta between them. Now, it is not true that Chuck's Auto gave these people a notice to leave. What Chuck's Auto did is they told them that the lease was going to be up in February and we're not renewing it. They never filed, they never asked them to leave early, and Mr. Stowe stayed there through the end of his lease. Then he got his security deposit back. That was in February. It wasn't until March then of 2015 that he told Chuck's Auto that he had this claim regarding his vehicle. He didn't tell them in November. They are testifying that they notified Chuck of these problems. There's no evidence of that. There's no email, there's no letter, there's nothing in writing that says in November that they had these problems with the truck. That didn't come up until March after they had left after the expiration of the lease. What Chuck's Auto says is that we came to the building because their automotive repair business is on the other side of this building, and when they came that next day, Chris Hurt saw shingles standing up from the wind. He went up that very next day and refastened them. He testified that those shingles weren't blown off, that they were just loose, and he went up and refastened them. He also had gotten Google search images of the building months before these folks occupied it, and that Google, those Google photos that are in the evidence show the same areas of repair prior to the time that Mr. Stowe came in, and those same areas were the same as they were afterwards. That pictorial evidence is in the file. Mr. Dice went up. He said he could see where the shingles came loose. He could see that those shingles were refastened, but he said that that repair happened sometime before 2014. He can tell how long a shingle has been on by way of the way that it is weathering. So Mr. Dice didn't go and say, hey, this roof is in a terrible mess. He said there was a repair, the shingles were refastened, not replaced, and there was no evidence that he said that those shingles came off of that roof. So the question is, where'd the shingles come from? Mr. Hurt's son, Chris, who's there every day, said, I know where they came from. You know, we've taken shingles and placed them underneath the downspouts to move the water away, and those are the shingles. And all that we can opine is that Mr. Stowe pulled some of those shingles out and is claiming that those shingles damaged his truck. It is of interest to me that we asked them not to repair the truck so they could bring it in and let the judge look at it, because they're saying that there were damages all around this truck. I don't know how a shingle coming off of a roof, unless it's in a vortex, could have caused all the damage to the truck. They claim that the truck was pristine, and yet we do have evidence that there was damage on another area of the truck from a photograph that Mr. Hurt had had prior to this time. So their argument that the truck was pristine is not supported by the evidence. Had they brought the truck in and let the trial court look at it, the court could have got a better idea. I can't imagine how, with the scenario that they are giving, there could have been damage to this truck in all the different places that they said were damaged by this. And again, this is evidenced by photographs of the truck before this happened. Nobody came in to court other than Mr. Stowe and his son and said that these shingles had caused the damages to these trucks. The truck was reviewed by several automotive repair places. None of them came back and testified that these damages were consistent with being struck by these shingles.
Are you suggesting then that the Mr. Stowe or his son took the shingle from underneath the downspout and scratched the vehicle?
No, I'm not suggesting that. I'm suggesting that I don't know how the truck was damaged.
And there's not enough evidence to show.
The truck was damaged. I'm suggesting that there was damage to the truck before this date. I'm suggesting that there were some shingles that stood up on end in November, and they want to testify that they took pictures on November 24th and 25th, the sun. On cross-examination, he finally admitted that no, they weren't taken that day. They were taken some time later. So I'm suggesting that the truck may have had damages on it, but we don't know what caused it. And I'm suggesting that in this vendetta, that Mr. Stowe saw an opportunity to raise this issue, and he got these shingles that were there.
Now, what's the record say as to whether or not the truck was there when Chuck's was actually doing the repair?
Oh, the truck was there, and they had the truck there. They claimed that on November 24th, these shingles came off and damaged it. You know, my client says they never told us that. We came and saw that the shingles were loose, so we went up and fixed them. Then they say that they left it there. I mean, if your truck was sitting there getting damaged by shingles, why wouldn't you move it? They left it there and said there was more damage the next day caused by these shingles, and they showed these shingles. Mr. Dice testified that these shingles don't match any of the shingles that were ever on the roof. So I think that there's no evidence that any shingles came off the roof. As a matter of fact, if you look at the Google Earth pictures, the condition of the roof was the same at the time they moved in and after they left. There's no evidence that anything came off. And this is just part of this vendetta that has gone on in this case that continues here. It's hard to comprehend. But I think in summary, if we look at the law, SB Contracting was a party to the lease, not Mr. Stowe. The obligations in that commercial lease to maintain are not under commercial lease law an absolute guarantor. All Chuck's Auto has to do is use reasonably appropriate efforts to make those repairs. And the evidence is that the shingles came loose on November 24th, and by November 25th, they were fixed and reapplied. All the other stuff in this case, the complaints about leaking water inside, which my client denies, shutting off the electricity, which my client denies, moving a porta potty, which we had no obligation to provide, all these other things that you see in this case are just dust. The real issue here deals with this truck and whether Chuck's failed to do anything required for them to do under the lease. And I can tell you, I believe the trial court, the magistrate, took great pains to listen to this case. We were there for 2 days and made a decision. And part of it went against us, part of it went against them. I think that court did its job. Thank you.
With all due respect to counsel, I'd like to clarify some issues that I think were erroneously stated. Number one, if you take a clear look at the lease agreement indicates that it is between Chuck's Automotive Repair and John R. Stowe, lessee. Doesn't say that it's between SB Contracting. It says John R. Stowe, lessee. as managing member of SB. Now, no one here can tell me that that language excludes John Stowe as the lessee. It's clearly written in his name by Chuck Spada. That's number one. Number two, indication was made that we didn't have the right to do anything with automobiles. Page two of this lease, use of premises. Section 8A, automobile repairs excluded except personal vehicles. They made a big deal about the fact that my client used the property to repair his own personal vehicles. The fact is the lease allows him to do that. They were asked whether or not they could prove that any vehicle that he repaired on that site was anything other than his, and they could not do it. So that is a misrepresentation. Number three, the lease is a lease that goes from February to February. They overstayed the lease. And my client was issued a notice of termination in late November and told to vacate the property by December 31st. He vacated the property December 31st, as instructed by Chuck's Auto. He did not extend the lease through February as it was represented to you. Number four, and the one item that said that this is not residential. The cases that I've cited to you all deal with contractual provisions between a landlord and a tenant. It is a contractual issue. Nowhere in any of those cases do they state that the contractual provisions do not apply or that they're only applied through statute. Those are contractual provisions that apply, period. Whether this is a residential lease or a commercial lease, the contract provisions apply. Nothing in those cases say anything to the contrary. With regards to the vehicle, the defendants were given the opportunity to review the vehicle. We took it to their expert. Their expert reviewed all of the damages. Mr. Stowe opined at trial that the shingles came down. They struck the car. They left a tar mark where the initial impact was from the asphalt shingle, that the granular surface on the shingles as they slid to the ground scratched the car. No one rebutted that.
Chuck's expert or your expert?
This Mr. Stowe testified to this on his opinion, and it was never rebutted, period. No one offered anything to the contrary on that. Even though they had hired an expert, he wasn't made available, didn't come in and testify. Mr. Dice testified, was handed a photograph that was taken when the defendant reviewed the car down at Universal Body. He said, based upon the photograph, it did not look like the shingle that was in the photograph matched the shingles on the roof. I agree with that. It didn't. But we had the actual shingles at trial. Mr. Dice looked at the actual shingles and said, yes, those are the shingles that match the shingles on the roof. And they show that they were attached, nailed, and stapled to that roof. He witnessed the actual shingles at trial. With regard to the car, as I indicated, the car was available. Now, counsel did say one thing that I think is so important in this case. Who do you believe? Mr. Stowe is a tenant. He's testified to all the facts. He's given all the photographs. He's given the shingles. Everything is there. He's testified. He tried to get a hold of this gentleman. The day of, the next day, his son tried to reach him the next Saturday. When that got hairy, the discussion ended. But here's the thing that's in this transcript. When the lease was entered into, the landlord said that he would fix the door, he'd fix the entrance pad so that he could use it to run his fork truck back and forth. He'll put in a gravel parking lot. He did none of those. He provided at this time that there was toilet facilities available in a portalet. There was none inside. Months later, he testified, I removed the portalet because I didn't want to pay for it anymore.
But that's your right.
1 minute?
Wrap up,
please. Okay. With regards to the electric, he did discontinue electric. He shut the electric off, and we had the police go out and order him to reinstate the electric. He shut the water off a month before this occurred, and it never came back on from the time he shut it off till it completed. So you can evaluate for yourself who the honest people in this particular case is.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you both for your presentations today. The court will take the matter under advisement, issue a written decision, which will be on both sides, as well as posted to our website and the Supreme Court.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you.